enter the main lobby of our building, on the right wall is the agency's motto, and it's from the book of John, and it says, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free." And that really is quite simply and fundamentally what CIA does each and every day. The CIA really consists of four basic administrative areas. Three of them are totally overt, and most all of the people work in the agency headquarters building, and they have basically normal lives.
Was this threat still?
You're asking me a direct question?
Yes.
The smallest part of the agency, which in our parlance is the clandestine service, it's where I've spent my entire career. Our work is not in headquarters. We don't commute into an office every day. We live and work and spend our entire lives scattered all over the face of this planet, trying to find out the plans and intentions of bad people before they can carry those out and harm U.S. national security interests or U.S. lives. Matt Damon's character Jason in the movie would be a field operations officer. Jason would have been trained in self-defense, weapons handling, high-speed driving, disguise, secret writing, communications. He will be taught, as we are, an entire array of what we collectively call the tradecraft skills. The best plan invariably turns to chaos. And a good ops officer never breaks stride, even when everything around them is coming apart. And it can be very, very challenging at times.
I come in here, and the first thing I'm doing is I'm catching the sight lines and looking for an exit.
I really enjoyed the scene in the diner when Jason's telling Marie he doesn't know who he is, but he knows that he can name the license plates
of all six cars outside,
the clothing people are wearing.
I can tell you that our waitress is left-handed, and the guy sitting up at the counter weighs 215 pounds and knows how to handle himself. Now, why would I know that?
Well, that's because it's truly second nature as an ops officer to be highly cognizant and attentive to your environment and people around you. You are taught and you do work on being able to scan a room and then leave that room and sit down and sketch how it was laid out, the titles of the books, the clothing that people were wearing. You need to be very, very attentive, very, very observant. And Jason knows that he's doing that. He just doesn't know why at that point, because he's still struggling to try to get his memory back. I like the fact that the chase scene was not some souped-up high-performance car with flames painted on the side that was spinning rubber, and his little red car that was bouncing downstairs. That's pretty much how that would work. You're driving a car, and oh my God, you got to go someplace, and boom, you bang down the stairs. You try to escape. He was doing everything in a very ordinary, linear, non-high-tech way, because that's pretty much how it worked. There's a saying that in the hands of a master,
hey,
anything can become a weapon. The more trained you are with weaponry and survival skills, the more you'll be able to rely on it when and if crisis situations occur and you have to improvise, modify, adapt, and overcome. You see that with the fight scene where Bourne simply picks up a ballpoint pen off the desk and uses it as a field expedient improvised weapon, and you can cause serious damage. I like that scene very much because that was quite realistic. Actual fighting comes down to some pretty crude grappling, and you saw that with Bourne, and everything was linear and straight, and it was over quickly, which is how that kind of fighting really takes place.
We should never have come here. These children, if...
That's not gonna happen.
I have to tell you, as an agency officer, I mean, I totally applaud the idea of Jason Bourne's training and the wonderful line of demarcation between his hard, extraordinary operational side and his quite compassionate, ordinary human side. But in the end, the movie was really quite a thrill ride and really well done.